5 o'clock, and we do like to start on time. But this session, I think, could not be more timely. In COVID times, we are under lockdown, all the schools are closed. We're all forced to think and implement some kind of homeschooling option. This is also probably, at least in my class group, one of the most heated discussions in most of the parent groups on WhatsApp or wherever they are. The government also has just announced guidelines for online classes and recommends some kind of a cap on screen time for students. This has added to even more speculation. So today, Sipping Thoughts brings you an expert session from classroom to living room. How can we make homeschool effective? With Jyotika Rai Singhani Dhawan, who is an education and holistic development catalyst and homeschool champion. In this very special session, Jyotika will be sharing with us the strategies for effective online education, how to make technology useful, stress management techniques for kids, and more importantly, stress management techniques for us parents, online time, cyber safety, creativity, and how can we actually do effective knowledge building. Before I continue, though, I'd like to tell you a little bit about Sipping Thoughts. Sipping Thoughts is a multi-platform media company that was set up keeping in mind the tagline, Real Women, Real Thoughts. We are a no-judgment platform and want to create a network of women for women and, of course, men that support us. Sipping Thoughts is available on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and, of course, do check us out on our website. Lots of interesting content is available there. And the person that you have been waiting for, Jyotika. So Jyotika today is going to be our expert speaker. She is an education and holistic development catalyst for students, diversity, and homeschool champion. Jyotika has studied political science at JMC, and post that, she has an MBA in human resources from XLRI in Jamshedpur. Her organization, Orient Square, works with students across India and the globe on learning and innovation, diversity, sustainable development goals, and holistic development. They also run a platform supporting a network of parents curious to explore alternate schooling pedagogy and are currently in the process of developing a support site for homeschoolers and what they call unschoolers. With more than 24 years of experience under her belt, Jyotika runs a diversity and inclusion HR company and, of course, her social impact organization, Orient Square, which focuses on holistic development of students. Jyotika is a known face in media, and she has received many awards on equality and diversity by Femina, the Social Enterprise Award, and recently the DMA Award for Women Entrepreneur for doing significant work in social impact in India. Some do's and don'ts before we begin, some house rules. Yes, you are all on mute, but we would like the session to be as interactive as possible. Please keep chatting and sending us your questions, your thoughts. We will be unmuting you. Please do raise your hand if you're comfortable with the Zoom feature. We want you to ask your question yourself, but we kindly remind you to please keep your question related to the topic and please keep it to the point. And as always, please do forgive us for any technology glitches, because no matter how much we try, and I think as home parents, you all have been trying, this is something we cannot control. With that, welcome Jyotika. A pleasure to have you on Sipping Thoughts.
Thank you, Sukriti. Thank you so much. This was such a lovely and elaborate introduction. And I would really like to thank Sipping Thoughts for inviting me, for giving me this opportunity. It's humbling. And you guys are doing fantabulous work, as I'm sure you've got a lot of accolades and claps for the kind of stuff that you're doing. So let me, while you already introduced me, hi everyone, this is Jyotika. I'm your host and our host for the lovely session. Sounds very filmy, but that's who I am. In fact, I just saw a tweet from Mirzapur, actor right now, Ali Fazal, who is dubbing from home using a teeth strainer. Now, who would have thought that something like this will work for dubbing? But look at the kind of inventions that we are all having to do because of the times that we are right now in. I honestly think that we are probably in Vegas in an Airbnb for far too many days. We are losing money by the minute. You know you want to take a nap. You want to do your eyebrows. You want to straighten your hair. But you need to keep an eye on the kids. You have stopped enjoying the holiday and you're stressing now. But yet we have to be sane, I guess, for the sake of our families. And women are capable of that completely. I would actually love to get to know each one of you. But unfortunately, I don't think time and logistics allow us that. But we'll keep chatting as we go further, and I'll send you my email as well. Please feel free to reach out. So coming back to this session, it's a very strange scenario currently, not just for us as parents, but as colleagues, as sons, as daughters, as couples, as peers. All of us are trying to make the most of this madness. And I think parenting is no different. You'd be surprised to know that over 1.5 billion children have moved to online learning with parents suddenly becoming teachers. So I want to understand from all of you, what are some of the things that may have changed with you, your kids' behaviors, thinking, something? And please put in your questions on the chat, or Sukriti, you might like to see what people are asking, and let's try and address that.
For me, I think the big one is my kids are learning a new language. You know, so they're absolutely learning new terms like Zoom call, you're in a meeting, I have to go online. So that has been one of the big changes, that their language has been changing. Please do share any changes that you're seeing with your children, or questions that you have, or thoughts that you have about this. Not only children, in us too, we're learning a new language. So we're getting that. Yeah, so I think
you're
sharing with us.
Not only children, for us too.
Yes.
Correct. Right. I think it is of course all of us, okay, more tech savvy. Right. Yes, so technology has
are now like as normal as WhatsApp. So Seema says, I run an NGO. The parents of my children are learning along with the children, which I think is a blessing. So yes, there's education going on both spheres, not only for the children, but also for the parents. Reinventing the way we have to learn. Now it feels like the old route is maybe passé. That comes from Alan.
Wow, that's absolutely bang on. You know, reinventing, we're all doing that. In fact, right now what we're doing is an opportunity of reinventing ourselves.
Yeah. We have to be more alternate and versatile forms of teachers. We have to have more.
Yes, absolutely. Not just alternate and versatile forms of teachers, but I think alternate and versatile forms of learning. You know, different things, different aspects of life has come in. But we'll talk more about that. Resources, yes, I think that's a very valid point. How do you actually get resources, make effective use of resources? Yeah, I know this one. Althea, that best of both. We are worst of both.
this is the toughest one. How to maintain the attention of the children.
Absolutely. I think it's also especially true for children who are either very young or middle-aged. How do you ensure that they are constantly engaged? So we will talk about that as well. Wonderful. Should we go on, Sukriti?
Yes, absolutely. Let's start.
Okay. So, I think, like all of you are saying right now, there are so many things that have changed. But I think I'll give you a small analogy that if you put a fish in a small container, it's bound to run wild or become unusually quiet. With the restrictions, fear, the new normal, I'm sure our kids are going through something like this. But let me say this in a very good way. That whatever is happening right now, the world will never be the same again. While it, of course, may not be what it is right now, but it will certainly not be the way it was. It will take a shape none of us would have been probably prepared for 3 months earlier. But again, humans, especially women, are the most adaptable species. These interactions are our opportunity to learn and adapt to new opportunities. Skills that will be required in the future will be very, very different.
We're getting some background noise. We're getting some disturbance in sound.
Okay. Is it better now?
Yes.
Okay. Lovely. So So as I was saying, that I'm not sure if anyone has heard about Howard Gardner theory of multiple intelligence. I don't want to get into technicality, but probably the focus of on in the incoming times is going to be based on that. And we just touch upon it a little bit when we go into a presentation that we do. But coming back to you, you might say, I'm not a teacher. I don't have the education background, the subject knowledge. I don't have the patience to homeschool my kids. There is so many questions I'm sure you, you know, sort of have in your mind. Schools are carrying out a curriculum. They're even limiting screen time. They're doing what they're doing. But what is our role? Should I add to the learning? Should I take a back seat? Should I do anything? Should I contribute in broadening their minds? How much screen time? Should I not interfere? Should I interfere? So any other sort of thoughts that you have in your mind before we go on to what we're going to do next?
The sound. I think there is some disturbance that is coming. If we can just check that.
Sure. Okay. I've changed my internet. Is it better?
I think so. So I think the big question for me always is it even useful? I mean, my kids are very young. So they're about 4. So putting them in front of a screen, you know, although I do love the structure, I love the fact that they have something to do. But, you know, you often wonder, is it even needed? So what are some of the other questions that are coming into your heads when you guys are thinking about online and schooling and the way that schooling is changing? Please do share.
Yes. Okay, Asha says it's clear now. Good. Asha, thank you.
Ah, this one, I think Kumud is saying how to convince them to control screen time. The connection is missing. They're wild.
They're wild.
Yeah, so I think, yes, we have a lot of questions coming in terms of the minds of people.
Yes, absolutely. Is there anybody else who has a point that would like to share something? It's a need of the time, right? Absolutely, Althea. Yeah, I think, we often forget that we are a child's first teacher. Our child will keep learning from us as they grow older. It will never change. So I think the very important question that we need to decide is that whether we consider the situation as a burden or as an opportunity. And that will determine, you know, a lot of things that we now take forward from here, you know, whether it's we are going to do take this as something that, oh, this is an added burden to myself, or whether I'm going to just make use of it, maybe very creatively. So that is something we're going to present here. This is called, we are all learning collaboratively, but we've put together something which is called the impact flow. And the impact flow has basically 6 pointers or tips or whatever that you call for parents, which can make this phase more effective for all of us. So I'm going to now share a little bit on that, unless someone wants to say something at this point, or should I continue? Is that okay?
Sure. Yeah. I think some of the questions I'll just read out. How are we making them future ready? Yes. And of course, the biggest thing that children are missing their peers and friends and the fun that they had in a physical classroom.
Yes. We're going to talk about it, in fact, right now when I take you through the presentation. Yeah. Should I
start? Yes, let's start. Yes.
Okay. I hope everybody is able to see this clearly.
Yes, we are.
So, of course, the session is our classroom to living room. We just discussed this, that I'm not a teacher. I don't have the education background. And I said, we are our children's first teacher. So let's keep learning. Here is an interesting slide for all of you. For there are so many people across the world who actually do not go to school and yet become what they become. So our worry on, you know, whether they are learning effectively, in school or not, or whether they are, whether they will succeed in life. Of course, we are right now talking about online schooling, but a lot of people who do not go to school at all, including my own daughter, and a lot of others who are in the platform that we have gone on to do tremendous things without having to go to school. So there are some examples. There are some Indian examples as well here of IAS and IIT and MITs who people have gone through. And of course, internationally, it's a very interesting aspect for children to pursue. So like I said, is this a burden or an opportunity? Schools are doing what they're doing, but what is our role in it? Should we get involved or not? So here's what we call the impact tips for parents. This is basically going to talk about inside the virtual world, how do you make the most of it? How do you make the most of the mind, imagination, and creativity, some ideas as well. The physical environment, which we a lot of times underestimate. A blue sky, this is a very interesting concept of how to engage your child through a blue sky. And it's not literally the blue sky, but metaphorically it is. Cyber safety and controls and the stress buster. So we are going to be talking very briefly about all this. I hope I don't bore you, or I hope you find this interesting. I hope that I'm audible and clear and everybody can hear me clearly. So Kriti, is my voice audible?
Yes, your voice is audible. There's just some static. So I think that is just, so if we just speak a little bit slowly, I think.
Okay, fine. So inside the virtual world, so we all, I think that it's a very important time for us to know the technology. Even right now, the way we are having to do this webinar on Zoom instead of having a face-to-face interaction, but are we acing the technology with our children, you know, through Microsoft Teams? You're saying something, Supriti?
Just static, I think that is.
Okay. Better?
Better, yeah.
Okay. So, know the technology, like we said, Microsoft Teams, Cisco, whatever the child is using, I think it's best that you also understand the technology, how the whole thing works. The entire slideshow how children research through multimedia, through, going through research platforms. How do they do slideshow presentations? Podcasts is a very, very effective way for children to learn. Online groups, so people were talking about social engagements, that, you know, it has become very less. How do you ensure that engagements will happen? I have seen a lot of parents doing, creating a cohort. So they do play dates with online. They are doing online group collaboration. So we are, in fact, working with a lot of students where we do group research. And that gives an opportunity for them to keep engaging, keep joking, you know, working alongside and yet doing a social engagement with people of their same age. So online group collaboration is a very, very powerful tool, I would say, both for learning as well as for social engagement. And there is supplement knowledge building. So a lot of people who are going to school or not are using blended learning as a very, very powerful technology to add to their learning. And I'm going to give you some examples in the next slide on what we can do with. I would also like to say that it's a good thing that teachers right now are happy with one-to-one interactions. Teachers currently are open to you guys, to parents reaching out on a one-to-one level and having conversations. So do that and, you know, online, and make sure that, you know, the child's progress or whatever that you're worried about, you have a connect with the teachers directly as well. And of course, play dates, like I said, on Zoom, board games that children are doing, which is really effective. Here are some of the things that we are using, that a lot of children worldwide are using. I know the graph, the text is extremely small on this, but I'll try and send it across to everyone. Of course, everybody knows about Khan Academy, but there are many others which are very, very effective. There is 826 Digital, there is BrainPop, there is Holistic, there's BBC Bite Size, there's Code Studio, there's TEDx Build a Lesson for children. There is Exploratorium, which is extremely interesting for people who want to look at invention, how things work, etc. There's NAFRA for students, there's Activity Mom, and discovery education. Of course, Indian side, there is Udemy and Coursera, etc., where you can do a lot of courses for free or even as low as 1,000 or 2,000 rupees courses. So these work very well. Should I stop at this point or should I go on? Is it okay? Sukriti, you're on mute.
Is there a window open or something that's causing like a rustling noise?
Okay. No, there's no window open, nothing.
Okay. So there's just some kind of a rustling noise that's coming. So I think that's one of the issues with technology that you constantly have to face, that sometimes you don't get just such a clean connection. And I think that's something that we're all learning to live with.
Correct. Should I continue?
Yes, please.
So here's something interesting, and this is based on the Harvard multi-intelligence theory that I was talking about earlier, that while we are talking about only academic excellence, and this is of course also academic in terms of verbal and mathematical, there are so many things that one can do by way of imagination and creativity, which is based on this intelligence theory, and children actually have skills in all of it, and we need to nurture that. So whether it's verbal linguistic, it's mathematical, it's musical intelligence, it's visual, body, interpersonal, naturalist. So these are areas that we need to work on and how. So here are some examples. And before I give some examples, I wanted to understand from the parents that what are some of the interesting things that they have been doing, with their children in terms of imagination and creativity. So anybody wants to share?
So we've been using a lot of Boggle, a lot of drawing, a lot of tasks. So that's what we've been doing at home. A lot of stories, a lot of reading.
Right. Anybody else has anything to share at this point?
Quote of the day.
Yeah.
Nina's sharing.
Right.
I started an online book club for children.
Right.
Who is sharing.
Right.
I've taught them DJing. Very nice.
Oh, interesting.
So Rekha Shikri is sharing.
Interesting.
Cooking. Yes. So Arvinder Kaur just shared that. Listening to podcasts together.
Lovely.
They've also learned from Shurekha basic skills such as changing a bulb, plumbing, carpentry.
Wow. Interesting. Very interesting ideas. And important question here, Sukriti, would also be that to do a lot of these things, mothers also feel burdened in terms of, having to create this kind of engagement with the child. Is there anybody who feels that this is like an extra, activity thrust on them to engage their children? Is that something that's... Yeah?
Yeah.
I agree with it, but I think there could be very simple stuff. And I know it sounds very simplistic, but a lot of times it's the simple things that work in life. That if you keep a journal, of every day of what your child does or what we are now going to do, it might help in terms of, one day is the word of the day, and it could be a word called subconscious. And the word subconscious is being spoken about in various contexts to the parents, to the friends, to grandparents, to anybody else. Explain the word subconscious to your maid or guard or someone. So here's that word of the day that we're playing with. Story, like we said, storytelling is a different thing, but I think a lot of children need to be encouraged on story creation. Why they feel in a certain way, what they feel about a certain thing altogether. So creating a lot of stories, there is something called Simon Says Geometry, which kids play a lot, which is non-digital completely, and gives them a lot of insights into maths and geometry. Make a savings, how do you ensure that as a family, you ensure savings, and that's very maths-led again. Then, of course, like I said, that today we are talking about academic excellence, but tomorrow you're going to go to competitive exams with CAT and GMAT and stuff. And logic and reasoning is what is going to be evaluated there. So there are so many figure out sheets available on logic and reasoning, and children tremendously enjoy this kind of stuff. I've played this when Nandini, my daughter, was very young. Name, place, animal thing with a twist every day, which was that we used to sort of look at only the place. So if it's Brazil, we used to say, okay, Brazil is the day, and look at a name from Brazil, look at an animal that is found in Brazil, look at a thing that is found in Brazil. So we were developing geography through that. So every day we used to take 10 places and build on that. Of course, there are many others. There is recycling for creating a better world. So you pick up, and currently some of the children who are working with us are creating toys for autistic kids through recycling, which is very interesting. You know, you're recycling at home and you're doing something for good. Again, they are doing something for blind children. So how do you ensure that you do something which is for the greater good, as well as something that you're doing at home which keeps them engaged? Of course, I see a lot of parents who are growing vegetables, who are composting. If you heard the Waldorf philosophy, Waldorf talks about knitting and crochet and dance and kneading as very, very powerful tools for children to learn. Why does, you know, a washing machine, why does Surf Excel work the way it works? Why do you add vegetables to dal? So there are a lot of ideas through the day that the children, you know, work on, which helps them both learn, and they're non-digital. So it's non-screen time that one can work with.
One of the questions that's come up, especially from Surekha, they lose interest very easily. And some of the parents are just struggling with basic routine and indiscipline that's creeping in now.
So lose this.
That one came in from Megha.
Sorry, you're saying that they lose this very easily, the attention span.
Very easily. And now that we are in the third or the fourth month, I can't even remember now how many months it's been. Parents are just struggling to keep a basic routine, and there's a lot of indiscipline that's coming, and also with the kids.
Yes. So in fact, my next slide is about the physical space. So, and the reason I'm saying that right now is that the morning time, and statistics believe that the morning time is best to learn new things. So that is why, of course, schools happen in the morning. So when the classes are over and the breaks are over, and let them do what they want to do, just daydream and just let them be. The afternoons, I think, has to be for imagination and creativity. And the evenings, of course, can go back to Netflix and, you know, so on and so forth, is what personally we would feel. But of course, there is no one size that fits all. I think parents need to decide based on their own schedules of the day, how things work for them. But I would think that if there is one creativity or imagination happening in the afternoon, it's enough for the child to be engaged in for the whole afternoon. And morning is when you focus on your studies and your academics, etc. And evening, just let them be. I think just play or watch whatever that they have to, or just, you know, engage in something very light. Is something that we would recommend. There is a child who's very happy with what I just said. Yeah. Okay. So physical environment. People underestimate the physical environment, but I think again it's very important, especially in today's day and age. Even if the house is small or big, or you have a separate bedroom or not, do create a separate area for studying, or which has the books, the reference books, the iPad or whatever, or laptop or something like that. It has to be a little bit of a separate area, because you have to disengage yourself and come back to your bedroom or to watch TV or to sit with the parents. It has to be a bit of a separate area that you have sort of cordoned off and said that here's where you go and study and, you know, focus. And try and, if it's possible, of course, if it's not, it's fine. But if it's closer to nature, it's very, very essential. It is said, statistics reveal that the more you are closer to nature, your attention span and focus is better. So if you are able to put your desk near a window or a door where you can look outside, whether to the sky or to the leaves, it's extremely essential. If it's not, then just, you know, try and make it as natural light as possible, but just stay as close to the nature as possible. Don't make the bedroom, preferably the homeschool, because that's where you come back to sleep or to, you know, watch TV or something. But if it's not possible, then of course, cordon off an area within the bedroom to do to work on. I would again say don't compromise on sports or outdoors, whether you do it at home or whether you're comfortable sending your child outside. But it's very important to go out, get some fresh air, have body to work as well, and come back home, even if it's for half an hour. And of course, get enough sleep. Walk every 30, 40 minutes is after every session or after every class, even while they're attending the school sessions. The child must get up and walk every 2-3 minutes for 2-3 minutes in between sessions. That's something that you must tell the school as well, to give a break after every 30 minutes for another 5-10 minutes. I don't know if the schools are doing that, but if they're not, you must recommend. Here's what an interesting concept that we've been talking about, a blue sky. A blue sky basically means a completely blank surface for the child to work on. You know, you brainstorm, you free your mind without any limitations. Like somebody just said that the child needs to be engaged all the time. I personally feel that the child must get bored a lot. It's okay to get bored, to just daydream, to get irritated and say that, what do I do? I'm getting bored. And say, just think, just daydream, just be. And that is very important for critical thinking, for design thinking for a child. There is something within the Gardner's theory where we call which is called the moral intelligence. And that gets built through this blue sky thinking, your spiritual, existential, and moral intelligence. So we talk about, you know, things like Socratic questions with friends, which is, you know, why is life like this? Or why is this good or bad? What can I do for, you know, better the life of someone else? So things like that, how do you ensure that you're not just living for yourself, but you're living beyond yourself? And that blue sky thinking is very important. So we call it the Socratic questions with friends. They can do it maybe with parents, where there are questions and answers about not saying that ye galat hai, aise mat karo, or ye sahi hai, aise mat karo. I think they need to investigate it themselves, that why things are right or wrong and how they should be. Any thoughts at this point on, because it can be a very tricky one. Anything?
Nitin Dhawan has said the why of life.
Correct. So, you know, why we say certain things that we say, you know, there are things like smoking for women, or there are stereotypes like, he's looking very gayish, or she's looking very chalu. Or, you know, taking one assumption. So take one assumption a day, take one stereotype a day, and let's have, design thinking around it, critical thinking around it. You know, question that actually probe reasons, that probe sort of evidences in some way. And, talking about viewpoints, perspectives about with children, you know, whether it's on clothes or whether somebody's fat or slim, or body, you know, types, of maybe things on Syria if they are old enough, maybe things on gender equality, recycling. So design thinking, the critical thinking is very, very important, especially with where the world is going right now. And that the children must be given, or maybe actually nurtured effectively.
So Lena is saying, explain the no. Seema Seth is saying the paradigm shifts. Megha, instead of ending stories with reading out the moral, leave it open-ended. Very nice.
Very nice. Very nice. Excellent. I think, the important thing is that the child must make connections between what is being learned in the class to the world outside the classroom. That is very important through this blue sky thinking, that whatever that I've, understood, how am I incorporating the education? How am I even inventing something? I'm looking at something at a very different point of view. Am I able to see the big picture with so that I think the nurturing, the effective nurturing is very, very critical. Let me go forward.
Yeah, Sandeep is also sharing. Recently, he asked his son to get his cycle fixed and asked him to take money, how much he thinks would be necessary. He had an experience and he summarized, it's difficult to earn money.
Yeah. Correct. So, yeah. So it's, I think it's it's an ability to access higher meaning, values, purpose, to whatever the unconscious aspect of the self and to understand these meanings. So, and all these should arise out of a certain investigation that the child himself is doing, not that we are saying ki aise hota hai aur aise hona chahiye. So this is of course something very basic on cyber safety, but I think with the day and age that we live in, this is something that has, this has become very, very important. How do we activate parent control options? Do you get, you know, the software and whatever, sorry, malware is the wrong word. Malware, I think, is the virus. But so get the software that blocks access. You know, of course, you check your cards and take your child seriously if they report an uncomfortable online exchange. But at the same time, I think don't scare the child because technology is here to stay. You know, if there is an uncomfortable exchange online and then suddenly the mother says, "Aage se tu gaya na site pe to dekhna," or something like that, that scares the child. The idea is that you, you know, sort of share what is to be done in the situation and do share, do talk every time something like this happens, do come back to us and tell us. But let it happen because technology is not going back anywhere. We are only going to get more and more involved in it. So of course, we all know this, don't share personal information, use only a screen name and yeah, threatening mail. But I think the important thing is talk. Build that bridge with your, with the children that they're able to tell you. That's the most important thing, I would think. Any uncomfortable or any experiences in this area that anybody would like to share, how they managed it, how they tackled something like this in terms of cyber safety or protocols of internet? No, not really. That's great. On this note, I think I'd also like to talk a little bit about the screen time, because a lot of parents have separately asked me this, that how much screen time is okay for the child. And I would say 3 to 4 hours in total is fine if it includes the school time and research, etc. But if you think the child is becoming obese or, you know, disrupting the sleep pattern, then of course, please limit it. There is an option to review the display brightness setting in your laptops or screen. So you can do that in order for him to get less affected by it. And of course, you walk every 5 minutes after every 30 minutes, and that helps on the screen time bit.
And is the screen time different for different ages? Because I think that's the biggest thing that's come out in this government recommendations, right? For different ages, how much screen time or how much online schooling should there be?
So I think the government is recommending through the Pragyata also that I was reading about, on 1 hour for 30 minutes to 1 hour for the toddlers and 1 to 2 hours for the middle-aged children and 2 to 3 hours for the older children. But the reality is that I think beyond school education, children are going to be online even after that. So whether it's going to be, you know, probably research or probably, you know, WhatsApp or Zoom or something else, it's going to be. So I think 1 hour beyond what has been the teaching, the academic time, beyond that 1 to 1.5 hours should be enough for every child. Yeah. So coming back to the end of this, which is that we are not alone. We are all in this together. And I think it's only human to get irritated and to feel very stressful about this situation. But I think try not to bring the stress on performance, because every child does well. Every child is unique. They will do what they have to do eventually in life. So this phase is not going to be something that will affect them or their performance in any way. So choose activities with from your point of view also that makes you happy. Don't always think of what the child needs. You should always look at what you need. and connect with fellow parents. So many people, we are all, you know, having these groups and discussing how to make use, best use of this time. And I think avoid overscheduling. We all tend to become very hyper and say, ye bhi karte hain, aaj ye bhi karte hain, wo bhi karte hain. Let's probably not do that. And social media only adds to this, that this is now going to happen like this. Now the schools are saying this. Now CBSE has reduced the syllabus. Now something else is happening. So let not social media take over our fears and what we are thinking. So yeah, if there are more stress busting ideas, we'd love to hear and include it in the next session. Yes,
so I think Asha, she doesn't have a microphone on, but she has asked a question. So yeah. I will just, yeah, how can we keep children happy while keeping up with the schedule?
I think if a child is not being forced to do something, if he invents it on his own, if the imagination comes on his own, on what is it that you think that we can do today? What is one thing that intrigues you today, right now, that we can work on? That would be very effective. If we sort of overemphasize and supervise and sort of schedule it for them, I don't think they are ever happy. And even when homeschooling happens, you always let the child lead. And if the child develops, like Nitin is saying, if the child develops a schedule, you own it. They own it.
So one question that always comes, because, you know, different schools are now doing different things. You know, some schools are doing 30 minutes, some schools are doing 2 hours, some schools are doing full day. Yeah, so that means when you're talking about 3 to 4 hours, there's some kids that are in front of the laptop because they're having every class. So it's like from 8 to 2. So where is the balance there? Because we find that it's so different. So I think that's also causing a lot of confusion for a lot of parents. As we're comparing parent peer pressure, my kid is doing this, your kid is doing that.
Yeah, but I think, you know, at the end of the day, we have to sort of believe whether we, you know, whether we agree of it or not, that marks or syllabus is not everything. Your child is going to learn far beyond it through a lot of things that we'll do in life. It's this, how much time right now, whether you spend 1 hour on the computer or 2 hours or 3 hours, but he may actually go, his takeaway in terms of learning can maybe only half an hour. So if the focus is good and the interaction is going well, then it doesn't matter whether he's doing only 2 hours of schooling or 1 hour or, 4 hours. I don't think it matters at all. The child will develop an intellect irrespective of the time that he spends.
So, I'm just going to come back. I was just reading a question from Vandana. Your views on keeping the syllabus in sync with the school screen time.
Syllabus in sync with the screen time. Well, I think that the schools are decreasing the syllabus, I'm sure. So the screen time will be accordingly set. If it's not, we need to discuss with the school, but I'm pretty sure that the school has planned the screen time in line with what the way the syllabus needs to be completed. I'm sure that they are cognizant of the fact that schools may open in August or September or before or after, and they have created a schedule around that.
So Megha is asking, rhythm and routine are looked at as boring ways to discipline. How important is routine?
How important is routine? Yes. I don't think routine is important personally. It may, like I said, that some loosely aspect of routines are important. Of routine is important, like the mornings. Because the children is more active and awake, it's good to study. It's afternoons are very good for imaginative because you're anyways daydreaming. You're a little nappy and you want to think about things and just let them enjoy in the evening. But it's not important to sort of say that, okay, right now, 12 baj gaye, ab, study khatam, ab khana khao, ab imagination shuru kar do. I don't think that will work like that. We'll have to go with the flow and see how the child is taking it, leading it. Yeah.
How should you create a schedule? Should you create one with the child, sit with them? Should you have one? Because and then look at what the school is doing and what you should supplement, or should you be pretty happy that okay, the schools are handling it?
No, I think we absolutely must look at a certain thing that we are doing every day, but I don't think get disappointed if it's not happening every day. Whether it's an activity that you have planned or whether it's some imagination, like we said, the Socratic questions or questioning a stereotype or, you know, writing about that. This is something that will, sort of help them in gaining their both spiritual and intellect as well. But don't get disappointed if it doesn't work in the same way that you are envisioning it. But do form a certain, you know, sort of say that, okay, this week we're going to try and talk about these things and question these things. And then let it be sort of loosely scheduled with the child and take it forward. But yeah.
Yeah, Asha is asking, 3+ children, especially very young ones, can they really attend virtual classes?
So I think a little bit of creativity in learning is important, but how much they are learning from a virtual class, I'm not a strong advocate, honestly. So your school is going to come running to me and question me on this, but I am not a very big advocate of very small children attending a virtual class, because these are things that one can easily facilitate at home. It's not something that needs to be. But having said that, if the child is enjoying it, then absolutely, please go ahead with it. But if you think the child is getting irritable by something like this, then it's not important to sort of attend it every single day.
Listen. Lena, would you like to share? I've just unmuted you.
I just attended a webinar in the morning. It was about a happy classroom and happiness in the between your students, between the teachers. So this is the point that I had learned this morning, that the connection that you have with your students and the attachment they show towards you helps to have a healthier environment during your class time. And then there is happiness, you know, in the learning process.
Very nice. So, you know, I think adding to what you're saying, like I said, marks are not everything. It's intelligence plus your character. That is the goal of true education, like we all know it. It's important, very important for kids to work hard and understand the subject. But most kids getting 90% above currently in papers is actually resulting in dumbing down of the meaningful education. So, you know, this whole classes and marks are important, but only a parameter to measure one's academic excellence, correct? See, so everything else in life would look at, you know, whether it's your SOPs in college or essays or competitive exams, or life skills, they're looking at much more than marks. They're valuing your basic, holistic development. So I think the whole focus should be that we raise our children to be very passionate, thinking individuals who can give their best in whatever that they do.
So Megha has suggested, or some schools now have started radio classes for young children, more audio than video. Is that better?
Well, I think in the Gardner theory that we were talking about, there are children who are better equipped for music and auditory development or learning. There are children who are better at kinesthetic. Kinesthetic is what we call visual, and, you know, look, they want to look at things. And then there are people who learn better with experiential, you know, who want to understand the whole meaning, research, and apply to real life. So there are children who would be better in each, who would learn better in each kind of scenario. I personally like to look at things when I imbibe a learning. There are people who listen to it and work better. I see a lot of people who are on headphones and, you know, sort of very happy to listen to a YouTube video or a TEDx talk or something. So it really depends on how what the child enjoys more.
So Alfaya is asking, how can, as a parent, should I help in the new normal? What should I do as a parent?
Well, I think what we just shared, the impact flow, if there is something within that, the tips that work for you, try and imbibe that, try and work that out for your child. So maybe, you know, have a one kind of imagination every day, one or a week, like I said, or keep a journal, have stories. So there are various ideas that we discussed, and we can send the presentation across to you as well so that you can take some things out of it.
So one question that always comes up, should you measure progress? You know, when they're being homeschooled, because right now we're looking at maybe this is 3 months, it's going to continue on for another, we don't know how long. Should you be looking at, is there progress? And how do you measure if there's progress?
So, you know, of course, right now we're talking about online schooling, and then of course there's something called homeschooling, where you still give your exams, but you study at home. There are children who are even unschooling in the world, where you don't follow a certain syllabus, where you don't give any exams, and you actually learn through the environment, through the nature, and through everything that happens around you, and yet they do fine. So yes, in a lot of scenarios, I think some amount of progress evaluation is necessary to understand where the child is going, whether it's you know, your emotional quotient, or can you hear me properly? I can see.
Yeah, no, I think you're getting some noise.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, if you could repeat that, because that's another question that's come in. If there's no assessment, how can we know what is being learned and if they're actually learning?
So in fact, so assessment in some form, whether it's a formal or informal, it doesn't matter. But some kind of progress evaluation is probably necessary to understand where we are going forward and how the child is adapting to this new learning environment, or how much has been learned, how much does he actually understand. So like I said, formal or informal, it doesn't matter. But yes, some kind of evaluation is necessary. If you're doing this directly with the school, then understand from the school how they are doing this evaluation. You know, is it through worksheets? Is it through assessments? Is it through some projects or, you know, other assessments? If you're not forming, you know, following a certain school pattern, then your own worksheets through the sites that I've mentioned, which have blended learning, can give you an indication on where the child is going. Most of these sites have very good quizlets, etc., which can help.
Now, some people are very fearful that kids may be losing, especially in senior years, 6 months or a year. You know, so people are thinking that kids might be losing almost a year of study.
Yes. So they may or they may not. I think it's very ambiguous at this point that whether they are going to lose or not. There are various options that will emerge. Like I said, the world is never not going to be what we thought. So there are going to be a lot of changes. The children who have just given 12, they're looking at various options. So there are various geographies that they're working on right now. Certain careers have come up which were never there before. Certain courses have coming up which never existed. Curriculum is being reduced. SATs are being cancelled. So there are changes that I'm sure that the education platforms will also make to ensure that all these kids are included in the next year. I don't personally think that the children will be losing a lot, the ones who have just finished school. They will, in fact, be in a better position is what I think.
Fantastic. I think Alfaya is sharing concept should be more focused on than the content.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Completely.
So I think it's our anal nature, no? So when we feel that curriculums are being reduced, we feel that, oh my God, my kid is learning less than they're supposed to.
Yes. So the whole, you know, the concept, the idea of conceptual learning is actually what why homeschooling had started. That you know, focus on a lot of, you know, concepts that the child is going, you know, understand. You're able to apply your learning to real life scenarios. And what happens in schools is mostly, not that I would like to schools bash, but a lot of times it's a lot of rote learning where you are, your progress is evaluated on your memory, which is incorrect. So right now it's actually a very good opportunity for kids to do beyond memory.
One more question and last one. I think this one everybody has. How to bring that discipline and that schedule? Because like I think somebody asked that question before, that a lot of indiscipline is now settling in. It's been 3 months, even kids are tired of it. They'll open their screen, they'll go and play a game. You know, so they're there, but they're not there.
So what I said in the beginning, that, you know, we put a fish in a container, there's bound to, you know, sort of either become extremely, you know, aggressive, or you're going to be sort of, you know, going to be very quiet. But I think the opportunity is to talk to the kids, to set a schedule with them to let them own it up. You know, it depends, of course, I know, I understand that it depends on the age group and how mature the child is at this point in time. But it's possible for every child to say that, okay, you know, this week we're going to focus on this. Now, let's make a schedule around this. And mostly, if you sort of let the child lead and take the ownership, it will work out. So you work on, you know, each of these facets and say, ki ab, you know, let's understand, and you tell us how to take it forward. And it could work if the child, you know, it does it on its own. It has worked with me. It has worked with a lot of, you know, parents that we work with, where the child decides. And, you know, the decision-making is given to the child. They love to own it up.
And last question before we wind up, what if the parents don't have the time? You've got, I know a lot of parents are struggling with this because both are working from home. They have the added burden now of managing the home. So, and on top of it, this added responsibility of now managing the curriculum or the homeschooling for the kids.
So I think in that, the whole thing of develop new ways of learning will come in helping, will come to the rescue. How do you ensure to make the most of blended learning? That is the most important aspect. If both the parents are working and do not have, a lot of time to sort of invest. Having said that, I think a lot of parents, even if they're working, they will be around. So it is not that they will be sort of both out of the house for a longer period of time. So some engagements can happen even now, but I think blended learning can come in to your rescue completely if you don't have a lot of time in your hands. And I think on a weekend, if you set some kind of a tone, I'm not saying a plan, but some kind of a tone on this is what we're going to do on a blue sky thinking this week. And this is how we're going to create something. And this is, let's pick up one household item and you're going to work around with that. So things like that will set the tone for the week.
Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing with us, Jyotika, sharing the impact model. And I think, of course, we'll all have to be reminded about the impact model from day to day. Any last tips before we sign off for today? Jyotika, any last tip you'd like to give us?
Well, I think let children be. I think we sometimes become very, very anxious on how what is going to happen. But like they say that, you know, things always work out for the best. For us and for our kids, and I'm sure this is an opportunity for all of us.
Well, thank you for joining us today. I know I'm sorry. I apologize for some of the technology issues that we faced, but thank you, Jyotika. Extremely enlightening. We will definitely share a lot of this information on our Facebook page. Please do check it out on sippingthoughts.com. A lot of people have asked for the slide. We will post it there. We will also post the impact model there. So with that, I wish you all a good night. And like Jyotika said, let children be, let them enjoy. I think this is a new time for all of us to learn something. And maybe we will also upskill ourselves. So good night, everyone.
Thank you. You were a lovely audience. And I loved each question and thought that came. And Sukriti, thank you so much for doing this. Like, I think everybody needs this at this point in time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.